Hello, good morning. Hope your bank holiday weekend went well. You are very welcome along to Ireland AM.
You are indeed. It's Tuesday, the 8th of August. Lovely short week. Not a Monday, but a Tuesday in case you need to reset your brain. And here's a look at what's coming up today.
So scams are costing Irish consumers and businesses over 300 million euro a year. Later this hour, we're going to be discussing how scams are getting more complex and a little bit more credible,
yeah.
Which I have seen. Oh, there's me.
There's
been,
you.
How arrest,
was that? How was that arrest?
By the guards.
So we talk about scams all the time, but this has been going around for quite a long time. Why are you so
sorry about that, but it's too late.
Why are you so happy to be arrested there? You're like...
Just said that my microphone was left on, so the guards were called.
He looks like he's going to a
yes, there are lots of scams like these all over Facebook, Instagram. At the minute, use my face, but this has happened for lots of people.
Yeah.
So we're going to find out a little bit more info about it.
In just a little while, also on the show, she's amazing, best-selling author Catherine Ryan Howard, whose new crime thriller, The Trap, is inspired by a series of still unsolved disappearances in Ireland. You might know it as The Vanishing Triangle. It's an amazing book we'll be chatting about in just
Irish
a little while.
Irish writers, again, knocking it out of the park. And with feel-good 80s hits like So Macho, Sinitta is going to be joining us after 9 to chat the ups and the downs of the music industry and her close ties with, well, we know about Simon Cowell, but Brad Pitt as well.
They went on a date once. Close ties.
Don't spoil that. You'd be happy with that. I'd even be happy with that.
I put it on my CV is what I do with that. Alan, how are you? Do you have Brad Pitt in your CV?
No,
surely you've met him.
No, I haven't met Brad Pitt. No.
We'll rectify that this year.
Yeah, we'll have to do that.
That's it.
Now, later on, Showbiz reporter Mikey O'Loughlin is going to be sharing his story of getting a hair transplant abroad. Plus, what is your attachment style, Miriam? What's yours?
It's not good. What is it? Avoidant, dismissive or something?
Tommy, what's yours?
I actually can't remember.
Oh, we'll tell you later on.
Now, fear of abandonment.
Our relationship expert will be here and telling us how your childhood experiences can affect everything from your work to your love life. That's all coming up a little later on. But now let's go over to the Virgin Media News Hub. Here's Geraldine Lynch.
Thanks, Alan. Good morning. Sinead O'Connor will be laid to rest this morning in Bray in County Wicklow. The public is invited to pay their respects by lining the Strand Road as the funeral cortege makes its way to a private burial. Fans are continuing to lay flowers at the house in the town where the singer lived for over a decade.
Later this morning, Sinead O'Connor will travel through Bray in County Wicklow for the final time. In the house where she lived for over 10 years, fans are continuing to leave letters and flowers in honour of the songstress.
It's really, really sombre, yeah, just like reading the messages, and like she had a huge impact, I think, on pretty much everyone in Ireland, all generations as well. It's really, really sad.
She's been a Christian, I'm a Christian as well, and we just love her, you know, and she's very good. My daughter's special needs, and she's helped her a lot as well, you know.
Sinead's family have asked for the public to pay their respects by lining the streets of Bray's Promenade from 10:30 this morning. Gardaí are advising mourners to travel by public transport where possible, and the Strand Road is expected to close for a short period. Sinead O'Connor will be laid to rest in a private burial ceremony later today. Mairead Cleary, Virgin Media News.
An operation is underway this morning to evacuate thousands of scouts from a campsite in South Korea as a tropical storm looms. 36,000 people, including over 200 Irish attendees, are due to be taken by bus to safer areas today as the storm system draws closer. High winds and torrential rain are forecast, and the storm has already killed two people in Japan. It's the latest problem to plague the World Scout Jamboree, which is being attended by 40,000 scouts from 155 countries. Hundreds fell ill due to high temperatures and bad sanitation at the camp, and several countries have already pulled their delegations out of the event. More than 2,000 firefighters are continuing to battle a series of wildfires in Portugal. 1,400 people have been evacuated from their homes in Odemira near Lisbon as a result of one fire which started on Saturday. Temperatures have been rising in the region since the weekend, and highs of over 40 degrees Celsius have been making conditions difficult for firefighters and helping the flames to spread. At least 8 people have been killed in a Russian missile attack on 2 residential buildings in Ukraine. Ukrainian officials say at least 31 others, including a child, were injured in the strikes in the town of Pokrovsk in the east of the country. President Zelensky posted footage of destroyed buildings on social media last night. Efforts are continuing this morning to search for survivors. 77% of Irish people agree that walking, cycling and using public transport more often is important when it comes to the impact on the environment, according to new research by Red Sea. The report, which was commissioned by the Department of Transport, also found that 60% are willing to personally make changes to how they travel, while 73% of drivers and passengers would swap the car for walking, cycling and public transport for short journeys of less than 2 kilometres, most of which are currently made by private car. Well, that research comes as a new Greenway bridge is due to open in Athlone. The bridge, which crosses the River Shannon, will officially open at 9:30 this morning, completing 180 kilometres of Greenway between Athlone Castle and Maynooth. It forms part of the planned 300-kilometre coast-to-coast Greenway between Galway and Dublin, and it's hoped that the scale of the project will help Ireland tap into the growing international tourism market for cycling. Free GP care will be rolled out to children aged 6 to 7 later this week. While the move will be welcome news to many families, doctors have been expressing concerns about their ability to treat patients when the expansion comes into effect on Thursday. Sinn Féin's health spokesperson says there could be unintended consequences to the measure.
The minister failed to plan. He failed to engage. He failed to invest in training places. He made a big commitment which, yes, needs to be delivered on, but unfortunately it's been done, in my view, without sufficient capacity, and the fear is that we could see unintended consequences of people having to wait longer to see a GP, and that's something nobody wants to see. So this could have been avoided, and we could be in a much better position if the minister had engaged with representatives of GPs and GPs themselves.
And finally for now, the world's most threatened zebra has added one more to its ranks. The Grevy zebra was born at the Whipsnade Zoo in England last month. Little Zanabi, whose name means raindrop in Ethiopian, was born after an epic 13-month-long pregnancy. It's estimated there are just 2,000 male and female Grevy zebras left in the wild.
We compare 14 insurance quotes to get you the best deal. So choose chill and work smarter, not harder.
Drizzle and patchy rain will affect Munster and southern Leinster this morning, with central and northern areas staying drier but mostly cloudy to overcast. Winds will be light and northwesterly. This afternoon, you'll see drizzle and patchy rain become more restricted to the south, with low cloud bringing more foggy conditions to coastal hills and mountains inland. Increasing amounts of sunshine elsewhere as the day progresses. Top temperatures this afternoon of around 16 to 21 degrees. And widely dry with clear spells for most parts tonight, but patchy rain will extend into Leinster and Connacht later on. Widely dry by tomorrow morning. Lows tonight of around 7 to 16 degrees.
Chill Insurance work harder so you can work smarter. We compare 14 quotes to get you the best deal.
It's time now to take a look at this morning's papers. We'll start with the Irish Times. Its headline: Vaccine Damages Scheme Stalled Despite Pledge. Plans have not progressed for a vaccine damages compensation scheme as resources were redirected to pandemic response.
1 month's free rent for tenants in budget pledge. That's the front page for the Irish Independent. The housing minister is pushing for renters' tax credit to be increased to almost €800, as well as wanting to extend the Help to Buy scheme for first-time buyers.
The Examiner leads with 14 times as many listings on Airbnb as on Daft. Action has been urged to tackle homeowners who let out properties short-term without planning permission. There were approximately 1,300 homes available on Daft yesterday. That is compared to 18,000 rentals on Airbnb.
Delivery drivers now carry weapons for safety is the top story on the Daily Mail. Cyclists are under regular attack in Dublin and feel they have no other choice but to arm themselves against attacks. The latest incident was a rider who was hospitalised after being hit with a heavy item thrown from a building.
It's unbelievable what's happening to them. The Mirror goes with Garda dies in boat blaze. Horror. Detective Deirdre Finn, who is due to retire in 2024. She's died after a fire broke out on the boat she was sleeping in on Carrick on Shannon yesterday morning.
Yes, the Sun, the Star and the Herald also lead with that same story. Just horrific, and send our condolences to the family of Deirdre Finn, of course.
Yeah, just having a holiday like so many have. After the break, we are going to be discussing the increasing number of people, we talk about this a lot, but are falling victims to scams. But this time, the scam artist is unwittingly Tommy Bo. Like, Tommy, What are you up to?
Don't click it. We're going to see you. We're going to discuss that after this short break.
Just a minute. About this a lot, but last week the state watchdog revealed that 1,000 people a day in Ireland are targeted by scam texts or calls.
On a personal note, I was recently a victim of an online scam which saw my face photoshopped for a series of fake stories. Well, some, yeah, not great, some of them. We'll show some of the pictures of it in a few minutes, but unbelievable. There's me being taken away by the guards.
Look at the size of your neck.
Excuse me, that was back when I played rugby, maybe. said that the truth came out online, or live.
Live on air. His mic was live, and I went, so all of this stuff, it's been everywhere for the last month?
A couple of weeks.
So joining us now to discuss the significant increase of scams are tech expert Elaine Burke and Victor Timon, head of technology at the law firm Byrne Wallace. Thank you both so much for being here. It's a pleasure to have you. Like, Elaine, can we just talk about what's been happening with Tommy? It's been everywhere. Everyone's sending them to him, sending them to us, sending them to the office here going, is this real? Why are they allowed? Because I know that Miriam McCallan's had it happen to her. Joe Duffy, Pat Kenny. What's going on? Why are they allowed to do this?
So Miriam McCallan is a really good case to bring up because she did actually bring Facebook to court over this because these were misleading advertisements that were on their platform that used her image and said that she was leaving primetime to promote skincare products. So the scam there was then, if Miriam McCallan backs this skincare product, you should buy it. I mean, I'd buy skincare fronted by Miriam McCallan.
Yeah, exactly.
So that was the scam there. And they implemented a tool in response to that case. They reached a settlement with Miriam McCallan. But the tool they implemented was user reporting led. So that if you found you're a victim of this thing, you should be able to report it. Or if someone else saw it and was suspicious about it, should be able to report it. So they're still leaning on user-led reporting for these scams because Facebook says itself on its pages about its ad policies and its moderation that it's heavily automation-led. Not a huge amount of human interaction because the idea of Facebook, it's an advertising company at the end of the day, is that it has made access to that kind of advertising and ad targeting quite easy and quick. They say that an ad can be reviewed within 24 hours and a lot of them are published within minutes if they fulfil the review policy. They can then be re-reviewed by a human and pulled down, and that does happen in some cases. But if you think of the scale of advertising being pushed out on these platforms and the amount of moderation that's not done by human beings, you can see where the problems arise.
So why do they do it? What could be selling? Because a lot of those images that are coming up using my face, a lot of people are reporting them, but obviously they still keep on coming. But even if you click the link, does that mean that you sign up to something or do you have to go fill in all your details? Like, where does it go?
It can be any of those. So there's all sorts of different kind of scams. So you just really have to be aware of all kind of things. So it could be that, like with the Miriam McCallan case, that they're trying to get your money for some reason. They're trying to create a front to get your money. The front could be a skincare brand or it could be a crypto scam or something like that. It could be something that looks legitimate in terms of cryptocurrency because there's a lot of elements of cryptocurrency where you are technically investing in, say, a coin or something like that, but that itself is an untrustworthy investment. There's just so many different routes that these scams can take, but the reason why they use, like, celebrity endorsement and even that format of, you know, something came out live on air, those hooks to draw people in, they're just tale as old as time kind of cons. Yeah, essentially.
Like, they would have used for years.
Those exact same headlines would have been used for many different celebrities that they planted into those images.
But they are looking towards vulnerable people. And Victor, if we're talking about a situation where Tommy is saying on his platforms, this is fake, please report. He has reported, loads of people have reported, we know that it's fake. How in God's name is it still allowed out there? What's the legislation around this? Because it does feel to be taking advantage of people when we know that it's fake.
That's extremely difficult to get in touch with the platforms that are actually promoting this and taking money for it.
Look, we're kind of playing whack-a-mole out there from scam to scam. So, like, I'm in this game a long time. The first one was the poor prince in the desert who needed help to get the money out. You know, whack, got rid of him. Next up was the guys in Asia who wanted to help me fix the problem with my computer. Whack, they're gone. Now we're seeing much more sophisticated messages. And some of the things that Comrade's talking about will only help in terms of voice and data. In terms of your particular circumstance, like in Ireland, yes, there are laws that prevent fraud, and you can be brought before the courts. But the problem is, first of all, finding where the scammers are coming from. Mm. And most of them are outside Ireland, so that law isn't really going to help us. So, you know, unless you can, unless the guards can trace them, they ring them up and say, look, we'd like to charge under the Criminal Justice Act. Any chance of popping back to Ireland? They go, yeah, we'll be there Thursday. It's the first flights. And the guard says, great, we'll get you a nice hotel by the courts. So that isn't going to happen. So we're looking to lots of other things. Firstly, technology. And secondly, we really need to get smarter ourselves and how we help ourselves. And just think about it. If something's too good to be true, it normally is too good to be true. So we need to just start self-help and self-education ourselves. There is legislation there, but unfortunately for people like you, the online platforms, they're carriers, they're not publishers. So if a newspaper put that ad in, you'd have certain rights against the newspaper. Okay. The online platforms don't have those liabilities unless you can prove to them, look, this is harmful, and you have to take it down.
So but they can just wash their hands of it as if nothing happened, even though they're taking money for pushing it out there.
Well, look, there are countries in Europe where the regulator is paying the platforms millions of dollars to put up anti-scam ads to educate people about scams. And they're taking money from the scammers as well, and they're putting up their false ads. So social media is the Wild West.
But we keep on saying this. Where is the pressure coming? Because we know, we'll say, for example, in Germany, they've got lots of anti-Nazi, anti-hate legislation, and the online social media companies, they have to buy into that legislation. If something goes up and it's reported straight away as being, you know, that looks like it's a Nazi thing, it's taken down almost immediately. So they do have the AI, they do have the technology to go, this is a scam, take it down. Like, when are we ever going to get them to do anything? Because they're just sitting there going, not us.
Well, it's that problem with the legislation. It's the root issue with social media is this agreement that was made early on that they're not publishers.
But they can abdicate all responsibility. It's always going to be, yeah.
I think what they go is, look, there's millions and millions of messages and ads a day. And it might just be grumpy old me that I don't like something, so I'm saying take that down. Mm. Other people are saying it's a scam, so they've got to try and work out who's telling the truth here. It does seem to take an awful long time. And if you look at the Miriam O'Callaghan example and Martin Lewis in the UK, it took them the guts of 3 years to get the stuff taken down.
3 years.
Yeah, so it does seem an inordinate length of time, and they had to go, you know, through the courts to make that happen. And I think probably the platforms have some explaining to do as to why it is taking so long when some things are obviously, you know, not right.
So for people who need, you were just saying people just need to be more tech savvy, but whenever you're thinking of artificial intelligence, I gather they're able to trace people's voices now and make phone calls. Like, it's going to the next level at the minute, Elaine, and it's quite worrying. How elaborate these scams could get.
It is. Like, the technology does exist to replicate someone's voice. And your voice would be quite easy to replicate, but there's so much voice data of you that exists because of footage of you online. But it's actually much easier for them to just get a whole database that's been leaked onto the dark web and just spam text it and hope for the best. Hopefully at least one person in that list fits the criteria of they're waiting for a package, they have a son or daughter who may have lost a phone and be texting for something else. So there's actually much easier ways than using the AI stuff at the moment, but the AI stuff is how they can easily create, say, a whole fake website and a whole fake article about you or any number of celebrities and make it look legitimate. Mm. So it does help with that kind of framing of the content. It also doesn't help that a lot of legitimate news websites actually support a lot of this spoof content through recommendations engines that they are paid to host on their website. I have a huge issue with that.
Yeah.
They're actually, because of PageRank and the way linking creates legitimacy across the web, that doesn't help this situation. But the news publishers themselves are also short on cash, and this is an offering of money from these platforms.
Yeah, these are the things that you see underneath, like when you at
yeah,
the end
and
of the
they
article.
Have those, like,
and it's
he
got...
said X live on
exactly.
air.
Exactly. Yeah, that's
those really things
happens.
Aren't really a spoof all the time. But what they are doing is, say, some of the stories that were published about you, they're trying to get in ad money. So they're not actually trying to scam you as a user. Like, they are publishing absolutely fake content that you are getting texts about and your family's getting texts about. But their end game is that there's ads being placed by Google's engine or whoever's engine on their page that gets them revenue.
Say, in all of this, Victor, reputational damage is being done to someone who's being used. It's a fake scam. It's for someone like that. Like, you know, damage is being done. Mm. And then you've got people, if they fall for this scam, who are going to blame the person who's behind it, who's got nothing to do with it. Is there any pushback for anyone here? No?
It's not great if you're in that position. I think that, you know, there's no way somebody like Tommy is going to be liable in that situation because he didn't put it up and he's saying, look, this isn't to do with me. In terms of the platforms, they've tried to sue in the US consumers to where they have been scammed. None of that has been successful. They've been very good at just saying, look, it's not me. Yeah. And, you know, I think they do have processes and there's new legislation coming out that will make that complaint process supposed to be quicker and easier to use. But we'll have to see if it works in effect.
There you go. Yeah, this is a Bitcoin, an interview of me and Ryan Tuberty, supposedly on the Late Late Show, again doing it. Listen, let us know what you think about this. Have you clicked on any of these links? Or even Miriam McCallum's in the past, Gavin Duffy, Martin Lewis over in the UK as well, 0896 111 111. Victor Timon, Head of Technology Group at Byrne Wallace Solicitors, thank you so much for joining us. And Lane Burke, of course, tech expert. Great to have you both with us.
He doesn't say, don't click the link. There's nothing. There's no big secret.
I haven't made a fortune on Bitcoin, unfortunately. No. Maybe that's the future.
He wouldn't be here if he had, lads. He wouldn't be here if we had. There's lots more still to come on Ireland AM. We'll talk to you very shortly. Now, joining us for a closer look at some of the stories making the news is News Talk's Andrea Gilligan.
Good morning, Andrea. Now, we're going to begin with the front pages, the stories of the Irish Examiner and the Irish Independent, and it's all about housing this morning.
Yeah, the really interesting analysis actually in the front of the Irish Examiner this morning about the number of short-term lets available, short-term rentals, basically, across the country. And the property price website, daft.ie, a lot of people will be very familiar with it. Not every single house or apartment that's up for rent is listed on daft.ie. But the vast majority of them would be. And this analysis by the Examiner looked at the numbers. And when they looked at them, they found there was just under 1,300 rental properties available on daft.ie by comparison to over 18,000 on Airbnb. So if you're looking for somewhere to rent today, you know, you go onto the daft.ie website, you'll have the choice right across the island of about 1,300 rental properties. And yet, there's 18,000 short-term rentals on Airbnb, which a lot of people would tend to use, you know, maybe for a weekend away or for a short...
Sure, it was 12,000 last year. Now we're at 18,000.
Yeah. And in Cork...
It's incredible. And
Cork, 71 available to rent, compared with 1,662 on Airbnb.
Yeah, and the shortage is most stark in County Cork at the moment anyway in terms of the number of available rental properties. There's just 745 in Dublin on daft.ie by comparison to 4,600.
So, obviously, and if Tommy was here as he comes through the door there, and you were saying earlier on, sure, it's their own house.
It's their own house.
They can do whatever they
want with it. Which,
of course, you can. But I think, is it important to point out that with a homeless crisis happening globally, it has happened as a result of Airbnb. It's exacerbated the situation.
Well, like,
I mean, if governments had their act together and were building houses, but what if people, if you have your home and you want to rent it out, you can rent it out.
I know, yeah, but if you've got people in West Cork who are from West Cork and they can't buy a house now because of second homes who are rented out, do you know what I mean? Like, I totally get what you're saying.
It all goes back to the conversation around the right to housing, effectively. Yeah. But, action has been urged again to happen in this whole situation. The government did bring in measures previously around this where you have to apply for planning permission if it's a case that you're renting out your property for more than 90 days.
And what's happened with that?
So there's only a very short number of people. Like, for instance, in Cork County Council, like you mentioned the figures a few moments ago, there's just 7 planning applications from property owners for this is for the change of use. So what they're now calling for with the likes of, for instance, Sinn Féin and others in opposition have been calling for is for there to be more stringent punitive measures. For example, that the likes of Airbnb would be penalised on a daily basis. Say, for instance, Alan, if you put your house up on Airbnb and I go on and I rent it for a weekend, that's fine. But if you don't have planning permission, the calls are now that you would face basically a daily charge for not making sure that.
But it's my house, and if I want to rent it out, surely that's my business.
It is, but the result of that is that there's now the disparity of between 18,000 and 1,300. And
well, why doesn't the government then give more incentives to landlords to not do this?
Yeah. Well, that's that's a question you'd have to ask the housing minister.
But seriously, if they gave the landlords more incentives and tax breaks, and that,
if they charged them the tax rate that they charge commercial landlords, maybe we'd have,
more
private landlords. Yeah. What do you make? This isn't going to go away. 0896 111 111. And of course, we have had a terrible housing policy for many years in this country. That's also exacerbating the situation. But you know what they're going to do? And this is Philip Ryan's story in the front of the Irish Independent. Free rent for everybody.
3 months rent.
Yeah, well, they did introduce the tax, the renter's tax credit, which allowed anybody renting in rental accommodation that is registered with the Residential Tenancies Board, you were in a position to claim back a tax credit. It was up to, I think, €500 tax back on your rent for the past 2 years. What the Housing Minister, Dara O'Brien, has said in this interview in the Irish Independent today is that it's his hope to push that out, to extend that and to increase it as well up to about €800, because we know that the average monthly rent at the moment is somewhere in the region of about €790. And I know when I cast my own mind back to when I was renting until very, very recently, I was paying about €780 a month for a room in a house with three other people. So that's very much the reflection of what people are paying across the country. So his intention is to extend this tax back credit for renters up to about €800 and to push that out as well over the next 2 years.
And there was an issue at the time about some renters not being able to access that €500, by the way, landlords.
Yeah, the landlord, if your landlord isn't registered and isn't paying the proper, like if you're just renting out a room and you're not properly registered, then as a tenant, you can't avail
The good thing is, if there's three people in the house, they can all avail
it. They can all avail it. But I will just say that it is up to the tenants. Like, you know, check with your landlord. Make sure they're
registered. Well, you don't want to, because you don't want to be kicked out. Yeah, like, I'm sorry, but as someone who's a renter, you don't want to be kicked out.
Yeah, and there's nowhere to rent. Hesitation for why a lot of people don't.
We're going to move on
to... I don't want to talk about it.
OK, just real quickly,
COVID.
An awful lot of hospitals around the country are only letting one person in at a time to visit people now because of increased COVID cases, and there's a new strain.
Yeah, like, there's a new strain that's been registered with the World Health Organization. Yeah. It's been prevalent at the moment in the UK. I think they're calling it Eris is the strain. The HSE here have said we don't have cases of Eris at the moment, that new strain in Ireland. It's somewhat similar, I think, by way of the symptoms to the Omicron, but we do have a number of cases, quite a number of cases. In fact, 365 people are currently in hospital here in Ireland with COVID-19. 11 of those are in the ICU. Just one thing to note, the HSE have actually outlined the symptoms and signs again that people should look out for. Some of them are different to the previous COVID symptoms that we had. So they're talking about, like, the dry cough, head cold, various different symptoms. It's all on their website, worth for people checking out. But I suppose COVID-19 hasn't gone away.
Yeah. But we are living with it now. We are living with COVID. Managed
it's just if you want to go to the hospital to visit someone, you probably...
There are restrictions
in place now again, so they might just be letting one person in a day, just to let you know there. Now, later on today, at 10:30, as we've been hearing on the news all day, it's the final farewell to Sinead O'Connor, and the streets of Bray are going to be lined with people.
They are, and I know a lot of locals and a lot of, like, Sinead O'Connor's fans, even out this morning, talking about the fact that they're really grateful to Sinead O'Connor's family for... Yeah. Allowing, you know, fans and all of her supporters over the years to have
there'll
some involvement.
There'll be a huge
turnout.
Today,
So effectively, people are going to be able to line the Strand Road in Bray. I think the route begins at the harbour bar end of the Strand Road. It'll continue along the seafront. The Gardaí are urging anybody who wants to be there to take part and pay their respects. I think to gather from about 10:30 this morning, there'll be quite a number of traffic restrictions in place. There is going to be a private service for members. A private service, and then members of the public will be able to pay their respects afterwards. That's from 11:30 to 12:30.
Yeah,
the service.
And hoping people use public transport. But and
absolutely.
If you're getting going, probably get
please
going.
Please follow the restrictions around that.
That's very sad.
And that beautiful aerial of Sinead.
It's fine.
It's lovely, isn't it?
Fair play to the family for welcoming everyone there. Andrea Gilligan from News Talk, thank you so much for joining us today. Really appreciate it.
Now, up next, the do's and don'ts of posting about your child online. See you here after the break.
You're very welcome back. Now, in a culture where news spreads fast, it's important to be more careful about what you share, as we never know where it could end up.
Sharenting is a term combining sharing, and parenting. Little portmanteau over you there, and it's becoming more and more common. But when does it amount to oversharing? Joining us to discuss our parenting coach, Aoife Lee, and clinical psychologist, Dr. Mally Coyne. Thank you both so much for being here this morning. Sharenting, Aoife, obviously, this is something, it's a new term because we've got online. But in all fairness, it's been something that people have had for years, from photo albums to books that they collect all their kids' stuff in. Yeah. But now it's just everyone can access it, right?
Yeah. Absolutely.
And we need to be careful about that. Do we or do we not?
Well, look, I mean, sharing is what we do now. It's part of our lives. And, you know, I think it's a way of people and how they communicate and share their family and their friends and their work. And, you know, it's safe to say that we're sharing a lot more than we did 10 years ago. And social media has allowed us to do that, or messaging apps, whether it be... Well, I feel and I believe that it's definitely an individual preference, because either if you're sharing for personal reasons or for your work or your business, you know, for the most part, it's for people coming from a place of love, feeling proud, sharing and celebrating milestones and announcements. So, you know, it's all something that we're very familiar with, young and old.
Is it important to have a conversation, particularly if you're married or in a relationship with somebody, about sharing pictures, particularly when it comes to children? I know my wife is not keen for me to put pictures up of our kids, even of her.
Yeah.
So how important is it as a relationship before it kind of causes that friction?
Yeah, well, creating boundaries and expectations in general as a family with the kids is really important. We feel safe, we feel secure, and particularly for the children, it maintains a sense of trust. So when you are deciding, and it's not something you're going to make a decision on when you're pregnant necessarily with your first baby, but over time you start to get a sense as to what is really important to me. And if as a couple, or maybe you're co-parenting, or you're as part of a blended family, it's, you know, establishing and having that conversation, saying, you know what, we either want to keep things private, sharing that message with family and friends, and just kind of seeing how those conversations flow after that.
Taking extreme examples, Mally, I think the one that pops to head is Julia Roberts' niece, Emma Roberts, herself and her mother had a massive spat online because her mother put up stuff about her child and she didn't want anyone to know. So if we can put that down, surely there are instances where family and friends are putting up something of someone's kids. How do you broach that with family and friends without them thinking, all right, calm down, your kid isn't that special?
I suppose do it in a calm way. You know, like, you do have a right to say to your family member, I would rather, you can do it preemptively, like say before you have a baby, for instance, like I'm, you know, going to be sharing this myself and when I'm good and ready, you know, because like maybe your first instinct isn't to go on social media when you've just had a baby. I know that it's such a hard thing becoming a parent that for me, it was the last thing on my mind. And you don't want to be answering stuff on social media either at that time. Or else you can just do it as, you know, if somebody in your family shares a photo of your child, or a friend of yours that shares a photo at a birthday party or anything like that, you're totally within your rights to calmly say, you know, would you mind taking that photo down, please, or else cutting my child out of the photo, because my personal preference is that my child isn't going to, you know, appear on social media. And you are within your rights to say that. And I don't think it needs to become an argument. You can do it. Of course, you might be really angry and, you know, you might have, you know, kind of feelings of how dare they do that. But I think deal with those within the confines of your own home and with people, you know, that you love and trust. But then with the actual person, just make it very matter of fact, I think, as a request that they remove it.
Is there a danger for putting these pictures of children online? Because we see kids' faces being put and moved, and you don't know once it goes onto the web, like, it's not really your property anymore.
Yeah, well, when it's there, it's there. And look, I'm a mom myself of three kids ranging from 5 to nearly 15. And, you know, we have to be mindful. And I post pictures of my own.
But it can end up on very dangerous websites.
Absolutely.
You need to remember that.
So we have to be mindful of, particularly for our younger children, they don't have a voice. They don't have a say. They haven't got any opinion, you know, whether you put pictures of them in the bathtub. But as our teenagers, and I know this myself, our teenagers, preteens, they're more vulnerable, but they do have that voice and they are starting to say, look, I don't want to be part of. I don't want you sharing pictures of me online. But that's when they are able to express themselves.
Yeah. I suppose there's an issue then when children are younger, because, Mali, there is legislation being debated in France at the moment in Parliament in relation to sharenting, where they aim to make parents responsible for the privacy rights of their children who cannot consent to their images being uploaded online. The ability to do that might be taken away from parents, and it could be dealt with by a social worker, because there are long-term ramifications here for children who are 1, 2, 3 years old now, and what it's got, what life is going to be like for them when they're 18 years old, and they didn't know that any of this was going up, right?
Yeah, I mean, there could be, for sure. I mean, for me, one of the biggest issues I have is when parents share, you know, footage or photos of their children, of their young children in a very vulnerable state, like, you know, obviously not, you know, shouldn't be in any state of undress in a bath, or else there was, you know, when things go viral, like I remember during COVID, one parent brought their child, told their child school was back on and brought them to the school gate, filmed all of this. And then the child got really upset to see that the school wasn't open, and really, really upset. And I've seen other videos as well of kids getting really upset and the parents laughing and thinking, this is funny. And but sorry, also I actually people, think that's emotional abuse.
People are profiteering. Parents are profiting out of that by using their children on their platforms, YouTube or social media, to make money out of this as well by videos and clicks.
Absolutely. I mean, I think we just need to think of that as a parent. As you know, I don't know if we're going to go so far as France with the legislation. We probably might. But I do think that we need to think long and hard as parents. Why am I posting this photo, or and is this appropriate? And would my child be OK with this? You know, say if they're really young and too and younger than the age of kind of being able to verbally consent to that. But would this be embarrassing for my child when they're trying to get a job when they're older? Is this, could somebody else access this picture and take advantage in some way? You know, what is your intention here?
Yeah, absolutely. It's such a grey area at the minute for a lot of parents who kind of just think they're doing it out of being friends and family, you know, and not doing anything wrong.
Yeah. But the ramifications.
But there are consequences.
We're just not seeing it right now as much as we'd.
Well, Aoife Lee, parenting coach, parentsupport.ie is where people can find you, and Dr. Mali Coyne, clinical psychologist. Thank you both so much for chatting with us today. We'd love to hear from you because I think you're damned if you do and you're damned if you don't. What do you make about sharing your children online? 0896 111 111.
Now for a look what's coming up after 8. So over to Big Al.
Thanks very much. Now, still to come this morning, her new thriller is topical, twisty and a real heart stopper. We chat to crime author Catherine Ryan Howard. Plus, we're going Mexican in the kitchen with some steak. What is it, Jack? Tostadas? Tostadas, he's nodding. Yes, we're going to see you back here in a few minutes. Don't go anywhere.
Come on, Big Al. Hello, welcome back to Tuesday's Ireland AM. Don't be thinking it's Monday, it's Tuesday, 4 day week. It's all good.
Bank holiday weekend, can't beat it. Coming up this hour, hair loss in men. We're going to be looking into the signs, symptoms and causes. And we're also going to be hearing one man's story of heading to Turkey for a hair transplant, which is becoming so much more common.
But you can, I know we see like dangers with that, but when it comes to hair transplant, it would make sense, right? To kind of go to Turkey if it's safe.
Yeah, well, if it's safe, I'm sure it'd be easier and better to get it done in Dublin, but the price of it's so extortionate.
Prince William, Turkey isn't that far away. I'm joking. Bestselling author Catherine Ryan Howard, she is back with another breakneck thriller later this hour. She'll be telling us about her brand new page turner, The Trap.
And there's a fiesta happening in the kitchen this morning. Tell us more, Al.
Oh, well, it's fiesta time in the kitchen, yeah, Jack, isn't it?
Always fiesta when I'm here, Al. You know that.
It's always happy time here. You're making steak. Tostadas?
Steak tostadas are really quick, really easy one. Use a minute steaks, just flash in the pan with a little marinade and then some beautiful crispy tacos. Think of it like a giant nacho. I'm going to shallow fry this till it goes super crispy and then we'll put all our toppings on top.
And then you just bite it.
Crunch and it's all over your lap.
Tommy, oh, I'm telling you, I can't wait. That's telling you Tommy's all excited about that.
We compare 14 insurance quotes to get you the best deal. So choose chill and work smarter, not harder.
Drizzle and patchy rain will affect Munster and southern Leinster this morning, with central and northern areas staying drier but mostly cloudy to overcast. Winds will be light and northwesterly. This afternoon, you'll see drizzle and patchy rain become more restricted to the south, with low cloud bringing more foggy conditions to coastal hills and mountains inland. Increasing amounts of sunshine elsewhere as the day progresses. Top temperatures this afternoon of around 16 to 21 degrees. And widely dry with clear spells for most parts tonight, but patchy rain will extend into Leinster and Connacht later on. Widely dry by tomorrow morning. Lows tonight of around 7 to 16 degrees.
Chill Insurance work harder, so you can work smarter. We compare 14 quotes to get you the best deal.
It's time now to take a look at this morning's papers. We'll start with the Irish Times. Its headline: vaccine damages scheme stalled despite pledge. Plans have not progressed for the scheme, which is about compensation for vaccine damages, as resources were redirected to the pandemic response.
1 month's free rent for tenants in budget pledge. That's the front page of the Irish Independent. The housing minister is pushing for renters' tax credit to be increased to almost €800, as well as wanting to extend the Help to Buy scheme for first-time buyers.
The Examiner leads with 14 times as many listings on Airbnb as on Daft. Action has been urged to tackle homeowners who let out properties short-term without planning permission. There were approximately 1,300 homes available on Daft yesterday. That is compared to 18,000 rentals on Airbnb.
Delivery drivers now carry weapons for safety is the top story on the Daily Mail. Cyclists are under regular attack in Dublin and feel they have no other choice but to arm themselves against attacks. The latest incident was of a rider who was hospitalised after being hit with a heavy item thrown from a building.
The Mirror goes with Garda dies in boat blaze. Horror detective Deirdre Finn, who was due to retire in 2024, has died after a fire broke out on the boat she was sleeping in on Carrick-on-Shannon yesterday morning.
Yes, the Sun, the Star and the Herald also leave with that same sad story.
They certainly do.
Now, we were talking on Making the News earlier about 14 times as many listings on Airbnb as Daft.
Mm-hmm. Although it's gone up almost 6,000 since last year. It was 12,000, about 12,000 on Airbnb last year.
That's about 18.
And now it's 18,000.
Like, it just shows the market that's out there for Airbnb, for short-term
nets. Does,
you can charge £800 for two nights.
And people are obviously doing it, you know? And you can make more money in a couple of nights than you can make in a month's rent.
Go on, read it out. You were dying to get this one out.
Unfortunately, Grania doesn't believe with Alan, though, because Alan believes that if you are a private land, or you own the building.
No, I think there should be more incentives for landlords to stay in the market. And I think the government should be able, I think people should be able to do what they want with their house. But I do think there should be more incentives for landlords by the government to stay in the rental market.
Well, Grania disagrees. She says, I have to disagree with Alan. Housing should not be allowed to be used as a commodity for profit during a housing crisis. We should be doing anything possible to make as many affordable rooms available as possible.
And what would help would be taxing private landlords at the same rate as commercial landlords. Because if you're being taxed up to 50% as a private landlord, and a commercial landlord's being taxed 20%. What is going on
exactly
there?
Exactly. So that's what I mean.
Crazy.
And Mike says that the government should not tell private owners how they can use their private properties. If someone has worked hard all their lives and wants to rent an Airbnb, they should be allowed. The blame should not be shifted to those who own their own properties. The government should take the blame.
And this is an interesting one as well. Chris said, I am currently renting my home on Airbnb. I'm afraid to let it long term in case I get the wrong tenant, as it's very hard to get rid of them under the current guidelines. I also want to protect my neighbours in case of a bad tenant. If the government offered me more supports, then you would be able to do so much. But that is so true, that if you were to get somebody in and they were not a bad... Listen, most people out there are going to be good tenants. But there's no way of getting them out.
The tenants have more rights now than the landlord in a lot of the cases.
Now, we don't want to come off like we need the Land League. Do you know, we're sitting here inside of, you know, British landlords and we're around the time of the famine. It's nothing like that. But I suppose if you want to have a proper working market to get landlords in, they have to have some rights over their own property. I completely get that. Mary says, I'm a pensioner and during the boom, we had always planned to sell and downsize our house to something more modest for me and my husband. So we could save money. You need it for your pension. Yeah. You need it for living. Completely understand what you're doing. However, we have been left with no choice but to house our son, his partner and their child because they cannot afford any property in Dublin, and that is where we live.
Yeah, it's difficult, isn't it?
Yeah.
Really, really difficult. Thank you for sending in those text messages as well. We have a lot more on sharing children's images online as well. Sharenting is what it's called. We'll try, hopefully get through those later on.
Now, coming up after the break, men and hair loss. Should you let it go or replace it?
We're going to be chatting to showbiz reporter Mikey O'Loughlin about why he decided to have a hair transplant and different shampoos that you can get to help it all falling out. See you after the break. Good morning, you're very welcome back. Now, hair loss amongst men is becoming increasingly more common, with over 49% of Irish men under the age of 30 reporting to be suffering from the condition. I don't know if it's more. Do you think so?
Is it just? I don't think it's more. I just think more people are aware of it and more people are talking about it. And we're talking about it this morning, and here to talk about his own experience of hair loss and his hair transplant is RSVP showbiz editor Mikey O'Loughlin. Good morning to you, Mikey.
Hey,
good
Mikey. Morning.
So tell us, lots of people were seeing this going to Turkey, and we see the pictures on the plane of all the heads coming back. So when did you start noticing the hair loss?
It does go back a while. I'd say it was about 2013, 2014, and I started to notice small patches, and it was all at the back of my head. That's where I was losing my hair. So it was hard to see. I wasn't seeing it front on in a photo. I wasn't seeing it looking in the mirror every morning, but I was starting to get caught in the back of people's photos or being in hotels, the good hotels with the mirrors all over the bathroom, and you'd be facing one and you'd be like, oh, what's that at the back of my head? Then I started to get comments from people, maybe not meant so hurtfully, but that, you know, there were sore points, and I started to become very conscious about it.
Oh, did you?
I remember a hairdresser said it to me once, and I never went back again.
So I had said,
you might be going a little bit sparse on the top there. And then that was the end of that. Like, it does affect your confidence, because this is something we discussed to make the news, I think it was last week, that actually it's a real dent to men's confidence when they do start to lose their hair.
Absolutely, and I had a similar experience with a barber, and he just said bluntly, what's with that penalty spot on the top of your head? And I was like, wow, I just feel so great about myself that you're able to stand there and be so negative about me.
Like, and a barber should know these things, that people are going to be like, I've one at the back of my hair as well. I mean, I'm not going to do anything about it, because I did get a transplant years ago before it became very popular and well known to get it done. Sure. Why did you? Yeah. Oh, I did. Yeah, here in Ireland. Why did you decide on Turkey? Because I know I'm joking, all the people on the plane coming back, but what is it about Turkey? Did you research it, and what did you do?
It really came down to price. I priced it here in Ireland. I priced it in Turkey. There's a guy I know, and I saw it on his Instagram. I saw his hairline looked unbelievable. He was really receding terribly, and he just had this grey front line. So I reached out to him, asked him what the story was. He gave me a contact in Turkey. I looked into that more, and again, meeting people here in Ireland. And what made me go to Turkey was one of the trichologists I met in Ireland said that it just comes down to the price, the cost of living over there. You're not going to get any less of treatment. The service is going to be perfect. You're going to get great care. It just comes down to the cost of living is so much cheaper. The rent of the buildings, the nurses, the medication, everything is cheaper, and that's what it was.
Can I ask you, though, as well, even when you're making that decision that I want to go for a hair transplant, is it something, because I think it's something that people talk about a lot more now, that, oh, yeah, I went off to Turkey, I went and had it done. It was very secretive maybe back in the day, or people didn't discuss losing their hair and using different shampoos and stuff.
Yeah.
Like, was it something that you felt, I want to get this fixed, I don't want to go bald?
Oh, absolutely. And I think kind of the pandemic stopped me in my tracks. I would have done this a couple of years ago, and I wish I did, but just the way that the life fell. And, you know, you mentioned secrecy there. I kept it quite private myself. Even when I went, I only told three people. Okay. There was one friend in Dublin, one friend in work, and one friend where I'm from.
Why?
I wanted to experience it myself first. I didn't know what it was going to be like. I thought it would be easier in the long run if I just kept it to myself. I didn't want all the texts, all the phone calls, all the worry.
But is it nerve-wracking going on your own to Turkey to go under the knife on this? I mean, like, it's quite a big operation and on your own.
Like, I was called from my hotel, I think it was about 6 a.m., arrived there at 7, given a Xanax. I had my hair shaved completely. I've never had my hair shaved in my life. And I just remember standing there, kind of, or sitting there in front of the mirror, kind of feeling so demoralised and humiliated having my hair fall down in front of me. And then, you know, I was brought from there, changed on the hospital bed, never being in a hospital before, kind of only realising at that moment, getting very panic attacky. Okay. I get this IV was put into my arm and I just felt so alone, so vulnerable. Yeah. I just felt like there was nobody there to support me. I think at that moment, I just really wanted a massive hug. And even afterwards, I was shaking. You know, it was about 7 hours later. And like, I had to go and have a lunch and they watch you. And this while this Turkish man was giving me all the details of what medication, I just sat there and tears streamed down my face for about half an hour.
Was it a good experience though? Did you feel that they were quite comforting, although you were in an, like, it was a tough...
No, I wouldn't say it was comforting. It was a good experience
for them.
It was business.
Yeah, business for them.
And it was like that.
To let people know, you're awake for the whole thing. Mm-hmm. Did they take, because I remember when I got it done, they take a strip off the back of your head. And so you have a scar along the back of your head. Do they do that now, or do they just take all the little...
No, it was all individual.
Individual ones.
It was what I describe as like a clicky pen. And it was like 1, 2, 3 right across my head. And the extraction was fine. I was going in and out of consciousness and sleep for that.
Right.
And woke up, and then it was the implantation. I was sitting up for that. And it was so sore. And I just asked at one point, I was like, how long is left? And I was connected to different machines and I was trying to count when they were coming on and off. And I said, how long's left? And he said, 90 minutes.
Oh my goodness.
And it was the longest 90 minutes of my life. I started to count like 1 to 16, but like, okay, well, that's 89 minutes. That's 88 minutes. And trying to pass any bit of time that I could. And even, obviously, they were all speaking Turkish to each other. It's like, even if they were speaking English, I could be
at a bit
going
more
in, if they were having
comfort,
a gossip, I could listen in to, like, you know, what was going on in their lives.
So how did so it was obviously quite painful getting it done. How's it now?
All great now. I think it's really thick. So
it certainly is. So my God.
I have a small bit more to go at the back because it was a miscalculation, which was one of the downsides. They had said that I needed 3,400 grafts. And when I arrived, I needed 6. So that was nearly twice as much. But they'd only do 4,200 on the day.
That was another half an hour on the seat.
And, but what I thought about, but it was obviously negative. I have to go back and pay more. And
this time
I'm going to hopefully get it done in Ireland.
How much was it, Mike?
It was 3,100.
Then you pay for your flights and your accommodation?
That included my accommodation. So and I stayed an extra night. So I think that added the extra 100. And there was a few euro for the bank transfer.
But that is a fraction of what you would get it for in Ireland.
Absolutely. Yeah. And you know, you're looking into tens of thousands.
Yes.
Yeah. Wow.
And it isn't life changing. Like, this isn't going to be my hair for the rest of my life. You know, I'm going to have to look into doing this again, you know, in 10, 15 years' time.
Oh, right. So it's not a permanent fix.
No. But look what could be happening in 10 years, 15 years' time. So, and again, that was one of the delays.
You might want a different hairstyle back then, or you might want to go.
Yeah.
But so would you recommend it then to people to sort of, like, that it is good, it is worth it, and for the money, you do get something.
You can't pay for the confidence that you get and the lift. Anytime somebody says it to me, you know, I was back in Ennis the weekend with my friends and family, and just when they said, your hair looks so thick, like, the smile just went across my face.
Yeah, yeah. See, fair play, the confidence is there.
My daughter says I'm like McDonald's, mine, so maybe go and get M on it, so maybe have to go and see your man.
Thank you, Mikey. And of course, if you don't want to go through that, there are maybe some alternatives that you can use and start to use. And Sarah Cummings is here with a scalp consultant. Good morning to you, Sarah.
Hi, Alan.
Because, I mean, that is the drastic version of it, going to Turkey or going to somewhere here, there's therapy, do it, and other places do it. So if you don't want to do that, where can we start to maybe keep the hair we have and maybe to get some back?
Yeah, so with a lot of men, it is genetic hair loss and we can't stop that. But we can slow it down and getting in a really good routine as early as possible. With men, I mean, look at your family, look at your uncles, your dad, your granddad on both sides. And if there's genetic hair loss, then the earlier prevention is better. So men in their 20s, hair starts to decline quite rapidly.
In their 20s?
Yeah, yeah. Men and women's hair age as we get older and they shrink and can get smaller. But for men, it's in their 20s. So as early as possible if there's genetic hair loss.
Okay, so you have some stuff here. What is the first one that we have here? This is a scalp.
Scalp wash.
Wash.
Anyone with a scalp should be using this. It's a really important step in your home care routine. And as well as with hair transplants as well, we do consultations for men, a lot of men and who've had hair transplants and want to hold that hair and look after what they have now. They're after investing a lot of money into it. So step one, and very important, is the scalp wash from Terrax. This is like a reset button for the scalp. gentle exfoliation. Skincare, hair care is really looking at skincare ingredients now, like AHA, and this is a real gentle formula. No
what
grains
does it
or beads.
Do, then?
It gently exfoliates the scalp, takes any dead skin cells away. It's like a reset button for the scalp.
Okay.
And you pop it on the scalp, all over the scalp, once a week, leave it on for 10 minutes, and then jump into the shower. And because you're using that, your shampoos, your tonics will work even better.
Okay. And next up then we have a Grow Me shampoo. So I've seen all these over the years, these shampoos, and they sort of claim to, like, thicken your hair, but it's more thickening rather than bringing it back, isn't it?
Yeah, well, they're energy shampoos, and what energy shampoos are about is bringing the energy up to the scalp and getting the blood supply going. Blood divides cells, and hair is a growing cell, so by creating energy on the scalp as much as possible, it'll help create that blood supply and the blood circulation.
Okay, so now, tablets, we've seen these before, that if you take tablets for a number... Is it a month's supply wouldn't be enough? You need to take it constantly.
Yeah, supplements are a really good way to start from the inside out. They only work if we take them, and it can take anything up to 6 months to work. With supplements like a Nutri, an Irish brand, which is really good, they have formulas in it like nettle leaf, and with the Numinox spray as well, these have DHT blockers. And DHT is our hormone that's related to hair loss. And as much blockers as possible to kind of prevent that from happening. So with a Nutri from the inside, Numinox spray on the outside.
So then this does block the hair loss?
It has natural, zinc and nettle leaf, and they're natural blockers from DHT. Okay. It can slow it down.
How long do you have to keep taking that, though?
Something forever. A well-balanced diet, of course. Okay. A well-balanced diet is key. And supplements, all supplements will just aid that diet.
Okay, now, quickly, what are these?
These are great.
These in your hair. I know
really
you
good, yeah.
Rub them in your hair now.
So we're going to stamp the scalp. So we're going to stamp it.
Oh, you stamp the scalp?
Yeah.
Okay.
And this will help bring the blood supply up again. So another really inexpensive way.
Oh, by just doing that, it brings the blood supply to the
scalp.
To the scalp.
As we say, blood will help stimulate any production of hair growth as well. So every morning, every evening, I do it as I brush my teeth. So you can work it into your day. Yeah. And have
just as simple as that.
Simple as that.
So the blood's come up to the root.
Up to the root. And it'll just get the circulation going in the scalp.
Okay, Sarah, thank you so much for that. A lot of good information there. And once again, thank you, Mikey, for sharing your story with us. Thank you very much.
Perfect coffee every time. Tassimo sponsors cookery on Ireland AM.
Sorry. You're very welcome back. I just had a mouthful of chocolate. It's very hot. We're going all Mexican in the kitchen this morning. Good God.
It's Tostada Tuesday. Jack O'Keefe is joining us with Tostadas. But he's covered it in hot sauce.
Just he didn't tell me there's loads of hot sauce in it.
I know. So why not? Go on, what are you making?
Look, quick and simple tostadas. With or without hot sauce.
Yeah.
So to start off, we're going to get our steaks marinated. I'm just using really normal, everyday supermarket or even from your local butcher shop, really thinly sliced minute steaks, quick fries. Inside here, I already have some salt, black pepper, the zest of an orange. That's the skin from the outside. That gives that lovely zesty flavour, kind of freshens it up, makes it summery. And then I'm going to put in some orange juice.
Okay, oh, you can taste
it. That's going to give that lovely Mexican flavour. In on top of the orange juice, some coriander powder, cumin powder and paprika. Just shake that in. And to give a nice little salty, umami, savoury kick, bit of dark soy sauce.
Now, you've only two little minute steaks there. Would you need all that, like, for just those two?
This amount would do about six of these, maybe more, you know, maybe eight. But, like, with me, everything has to be excessive, you know? Just give it a good old mix around.
And best to do it the night before or even
No, with the orange juice, no.
Oh, really?
20
yeah,
minutes.
Orange juice,
because what'll happen is the acidity in the orange juice, the acid will actually cook the steaks and they'll end up turning into rubber. So just about 20 minutes is perfectly fine.
Okay.
I have my frying pan heated up to a high heat, nice and hot. You can see the smoke coming off of it. But if the weather turns out to be nice, it could be a surprise for us. You could do this in the barbecue.
Barbecue, right, lovely.
Pop the steaks down. You want to cook them for about a minute on each side. Really hot pan, really quick. The problem with a minute steak is because it's so skinny, if the pan isn't super hot, it's just going to be completely overcooked by the time you get a nice dark colour on the outside. So high heat, flash it, bang, bang, take it out, carve it up. Now, to make the tostada, all I'm going to do is I have a pan here.
You just buy
a little bit of oil.
Do you buy these?
No, I actually buy the corn tortilla in a supermarket. So it's like a same as your tortilla wrap that you'd get years ago. Now you can get corn ones, and you can tell by the colour that there's corn in them.
Yeah.
Can't find them, don't worry. This exact same technique will work with the flour tortilla.
Oh, is it? Okay.
And then I just use like a saucer to cut out a smaller shape to make it fit into my frying pan. And there's about half a centimetre oil inside there. Nice
and hot. I saw you doing that earlier. You just had a saucer over it and you were cutting
around. I just cut it to make
them
smaller because they were actually as big as the pan, so they wouldn't really fit into it. Pop them into the hot oil. See the way it instantly bubbles up?
Yeah.
Just turn it over.
That's interesting. You slid it in. Obviously, you don't drop it.
Don't drop it, yeah. Be very careful.
It could splash everywhere.
And then just flip the steaks and you see you're getting lovely colour. All the spices are in the air.
You need to have the old extractor fan on for that one. The smoke is pretty.
There's a reason I didn't put any cayenne pepper or chilli into the marinade recipe because that would just cause you to choke up and cough.
Okay.
And then once you have a lovely colour, that's a little bit too much of a colour, you can take it out. Just make sure most of the oil drains off it.
Pop it on
some kitchen towel like that.
Okay.
And that's it. And make sure as well, look, once you finish the oil, turn it off. Move the handle away so the small ones won't hit off it or a cat or a dog hits off it or whatever.
Yeah. I thought they would all break up, but because you're frying them like that, I thought they'd be too crispy. But they don't actually break up.
No, they don't. They kind of stay still a little bit flexy.
Yeah.
But you still get that nice crumbly texture. Leave the steaks there to rest for a few seconds, right? Now, the sauce. This is probably where you're getting the heat, Alan.
Oh.
I've mayonnaise and chipotle paste.
Oh, right.
The chipotle paste is a Mexican chili just ground down and popped into a jar. You get it in every supermarket now. It's really easy to find. It's like a smoked chili sauce. It's phenomenal. If it's too spicy for you, just swap it out with something else.
Yeah, we did tacos with that another time. You can kind of marinate it in the chili.
Exactly. You could use that as a marinade.
Well, can't you?
But again, you get that chili essence in the air from the frying pan. It causes a cough and splutter. But you can swap it out with Frank's hot sauce, sriracha, whatever you have at home. It doesn't matter. I just mix that together and then I always put it down the bottom. So as you're eating, you're getting that lovely kind of creamy mayonnaise mouthfeel. It's a bit too early to be talking about that now this morning, isn't it? So just smear it across, then take your steaks, stack them up on top of each other, slice through them nice and thin. And there's nothing worse than when you're eating a taco or a fajita or something and when you bite into it and someone hasn't chopped up the steak enough and a full strip comes out.
Oh, yeah.
So I always just cut it across.
And to be fair to Alan, what he was saying, you think that to be really crunchy. Do you know when you get nachos, whatever,
and
they break up and crumble? But actually, because, I don't know, it's sort of corn tortilla, they're quite soft as well. Like, it bends together.
Yeah. And you still get a lovely crunch off it, and you get that lovely flavour. So once you've it all assembled that way, then it's pretty much just build it with whatever you want. I always use some white onion, just raw. Some avocados, just thinly sliced. Pop that on.
Yeah.
That'll kind of take away some of the heat. Some lettuce.
Mm. And is that goat's cheese?
It's feta.
Oh, feta cheese.
Some coriander, just chopped up roughly. And then you can take your feta and just crumble it between your fingers.
Delicious.
And what I always do is leave all this in the center. This is brilliant party food.
Yeah.
Leave it all on the center table. Let everyone just build
just
their
own. And you had the limes there as well. Is that just to get the heat out of it? Or
exactly.
Are you actually putting the lime with it?
I just put it on top so that the guests or whoever's there can just go.
Gorgeous.
Drip
it themselves.
And then serve it up on your plate, the lime on top.
Jack.
It
is delicious.
Simple as
delicious.
That.
Yeah, I've already
done a second one. And you can do it with chicken, you can do it with turkey, lamb, whatever you want.
Oh, yeah. Gorgeous, Jack O'Keefe. Thank you very
much. Thank you so much for that. It's
delicious. Tostada Tuesday.
Yep.
There you go.
Now, up next, she's an international best-selling crime writer from Cork.
And Catherine Ryan Howard will be here to chat about her new twist-filled thriller. That's coming up after the break.
Perfect coffee every time. Tassimo sponsors Cookery on Ireland AM.
Now she's a best-selling author and a Lego fanatic.
Mm-hmm.
And her new book, The Trap, has it all. Murder, mystery and missing sisters.
Here to talk all about things crime and to celebrate passing her driving test, it's Catherine Ryan Howard. Good morning. How are you?
Good morning. And I drove here myself.
This is a big deal. When did you pass the test?
So I took the test on, I think, the 18th of July, but it takes a while for the licence to arrive. So I've only had the licence like a wet week and I have been pushing it to good use.
Have you been trying to...
Congratulations.
You're like, am I getting carded every time I go to get a bottle of wine? Look at my licence.
It's exactly that. Like, once you turn 18, you're never passphrase ID again, and now I will never be stopped by the Gardaí, hopefully. But yeah.
Well, it was a big moment. Was it a, has it been a work in progress? Has this been something?
It's more that I left it like really late. Okay. And during lockdown, because I didn't really need a car, I felt, but during lockdown, I really felt, you know, I want to get up and go when, you know, public transport was restricted and everything else. So I, unfortunately, lots of other people made the same decision.
Oh, yes.
So when I went for like my theory test and for lessons, there was a big long wait. So it was quite the process. But luckily, passed first time, despite my best efforts.
No driving test disasters. Oh, that's a shame.
I can't wait for the thriller based on hitting off the curb and going the wrong way around a roundabout.
My driving instructor suggested that I could do a little driving instructor thriller. So you never know.
Wants to be main character. Main character. Exactly. We're here to talk about the brand new book. It just came out last week. It is called The Trap. Can you tell us about it?
I can tell you a little bit about it, because it's very hard to talk about this book without spoiling it. But it's essentially about Lucy, whose sister Nikki has gone missing about a year before the novel begins. And she's at a point where the obsession with finding out what happened to her sister has completely overtaken the grief of the loss and is pushing her into a dark place. So she's so desperate for answers, she's playing bait for the man who took her sister in an effort to find out what happened.
Okay. So obsession is kind of the
obsession
key
is the theme of it. I mean, I think the moral of the story is maybe just let it go. That's good.
Maybe just let it go.
Yeah.
But you did, if there's one thing, if anyone who's a fan of your books, you're, if anyone comes up to you and says, oh, I knew what was going to happen, I knew the twist, you don't. You're a liar. Like, the twist is unbelievable.
Where it says you're a liar. Yeah.
You cannot get the twist in this. Like, it's sort
of...
Got in the first chapter. You were done.
Easy, I'm good at that.
Where do you start with something like this? Because your whole thing now is, I'm going to fool my reader. Like, expectations are high.
I know, and that's probably, like, not a good thing that I've... In second thoughts, I shouldn't have done that because I don't know what I'm going to put in the next book. But with this, I started with the twist, which is also hard to talk about. So I knew what I was going to do. Something happens at the beginning and something happens at the end, and I knew those were the bookends of the story. Okay. And I just had to fill all the bits in between.
Okay, so you kind of start with the end in mind and then fill in the rest.
That's how I do it. Like, other authors will tell you, they literally make it up as they go along, but I need to know what the ending is.
Do you check with people to see, did you work it out? Do I need to, like...
Well, that's where your lovely editors come in. So I've a couple of editors at my UK publishing house and another editor at my US one, and my agent all reads it before we let anyone else read it. Mm-hmm. And they will, you know, sometimes they might say, well, when I read that sentence, I kind of caught a little, so we'll take it out. So we have to be very, very careful. Yeah, you inadvertently give things away sometimes.
Yeah, of course.
You have to be very careful.
The thing is with this book, and I think for, like, we've discussed, you've been here before and we've talked about the obsession with true crime that people have, but there is a nod to one of the most horrific things that's happened in modern Irish history, and that's the Vanishing Triangle, where we have eight women who've disappeared over the space of 10 years and we don't know where they are.
Yeah.
We don't know what happened to them. And that's something that you always remember from your childhood.
Yeah, like, I feel this was probably quite formative for me because I was a teenager in the 90s and that's when I started paying attention to the news and, like, what was on the news, that women were disappearing and no one was doing anything about it. And I still cannot believe, I genuinely can't believe we're here 30 years later in some cases and we still don't know where they are or what happened to them. And, like, I can't even imagine how their families get through an hour, let alone decades. Mm. So I certainly was thinking of them because sometimes, you know, when you write crime novels set in Ireland and you might have a serial killer or whatever, people will say, Asher, like, he'd go outside the door and his mother's neighbour's cousin's babysitter would recognise him instantly. You know, how can you get away with it in Ireland? But the fact of the matter is someone did or someone's did 30 years ago. So I was certainly thinking of them, although the book is entirely fiction.
Yes. Do you think it's inspired an awful lot of Irish writers? Because that genre, and particularly with female Irish writers, is just going through such a boom period at the moment.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's lots of theories. For me, certainly, that would be mine, is that, you know, if you grow up in a country where you're, like, women are literally being snatched out of their lives and, you know, no one is doing anything, there's a certain comfort then in being able to write a novel where there is justice or people are found and you're in control. I think there's some sort of, you know, I'm not a psychiatrist, but I think there's something there about regaining that kind of control.
And you have clearly taken from everyday life, you know, before, it's something that inspires you, 56 days, your
novel. I'm just very lazy, that's all.
Yeah, sure. 56 Days, the novel set during COVID. That
yeah,
is,
where did I get that idea?
I wonder where you got this, everyone being trapped inside. That is being adapted by Amazon TV. No big deal.
No big deal.
No big deal. So get your hands on it now before you see what happens there. But of course, the strikes are happening.
Yes. So everything is on pause.
Yeah.
But like that's true for everyone. Everyone is in the same situation. And I was kind of told like I was in a good position so that when the strikes end, things can be picked up again. But at the same time, I don't lie awake at night like thinking about this. I think. You know, I'm totally pessimistic and I'll believe it's going to happen when I see it on the screen. That's my attitude.
Okay, well, I'm sure something will because I believe there's a few irons in the fire with you.
Can't say anything, but...
We'll take the wink as a nod. Yes. With this other projects, we did mention it in the intro, you're a bit of a Lego fanatic. Any other... projects going on in that sphere?
I think the Lego is enough. The amount of money I've spent, I'd have an actual house if I didn't have all my Lego houses. They are crazy expensive. But yeah, we have moved into a sort of Jurassic Park Lego situation. It was also two obsessions have met in the middle.
Are you still getting reference to Jurassic Park into every book?
Yes, there's that has the biggest one, the trap. I think there's half a page of Jurassic Park.
There is. Right? Yeah. And that's what your readers want now. They're like,
again,
how is she going to get Jurassic Park in?
I have completely tied myself now into mentioning Jurassic Park in every book. I really should have thought about this better at the beginning.
But so how nice is that?
So what are you doing? What's the latest project with with Lego? Are you
the
doing
latest just thing, which I sanctuary? Loved, was a little Lego set that actually has Lego dinosaur poo. From
love
the movie.
It. I'll My leave kids you on would that. Love that.
You love Lego.
Oh, I do, yeah. And it's good to switch off because, listen, I would imagine your brain is just constantly.
You can't use your phone when you're building Lego. I'm not sure this is how Lego intends it to be made, but I'll have a glass of wine.
I think that sounds delicious.
Yeah.
Can we say hi to your sister who's expecting right now?
Claire, yeah.
Claire.
She's ready to pop.
Oh, we hope everything's going well. She'll be able to drive down the motorway to see you when the baby...
I'm not sure she'll... Oh, I'll
try. You will.
She won't fit behind
the wheel. She won't be able to drive. No, that's it. The brand new book, it is called The Trap. To catch a killer, she'll become a victim. You can't see the twist. You can't see it coming. It is so good. One day read, I will say. Catherine Ryan Howard, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks so much. Thank you.
Congratulations, Catherine. Now let's find out what is coming up in the 9 hour. It's over to Alan.
I'm out here, Tommy. Here I am. Yeah, it's coming up in the final hour. We have all the latest showbiz gossip, and there's only one person who can bring us that. It's goss.ie's Ali Ryan.
Hello.
What are we going to be talking about?
So the Strictly lineup is out. We have so many good stars and an Irish star, which we'll be chatting about. Harry and Meghan, they're not gone. They're back. There's another Netflix deal and the latest on a big Hollywood split as well.
Okay, lots of gossip coming up after the break.
Hello, welcome back to Tuesday's Ireland AM. I was late standing here, they're going to come out to me.
No trouble.
It's lovely to have you with us.
Now, she's the 80s pop star who is taking the podcast charts, taking to the world of podcasts. Sinitta joins us at 20 past nine to chat about Podtails and, well, her relationship with Simon Cowell and potentially Brad Pitt.
Also this hour, attachment styles. It turns out how you were treated as a baby could predict your future relationships. What does that mean about how our parents treated us? Uh-oh. We're going to be finding out more at 9.35.
We've also lots to discuss from the world of showbiz. And no better man, Al, what's in store?
Yes, we're outside here with Ali Ryan from goss.ie. Ali, we were talking about Strictly a little bit earlier. And there is an Irish star in it this year.
Yes, Angela Scanlon.
Angela Scanlon.
Yeah, I'm so excited for her. I really love her. I've been a fan of her for years. I think she's been climbing that ladder for a long time. She's getting very popular in the UK. This really cements it for her, I think. Now she's on Strictly.
Yeah.
And I think her style is very, very cool. So I'm interested to see how the sequins look on her.
I was just talking to Muireann about this earlier on, and I was saying that she's such a lovely, bubbly...
So nice.
She's so lovely that I think she'll come across so well and do really well on it.
Yeah, and she's a very funny, light-hearted person. Yeah. I don't think she'll take it too seriously, but she's the sort of personality. She can make it to the end.
Oh, probably.
Yeah.
Looking forward to that. And you have lots more showbiz gossip for us. All right, that's all coming up a little later on.
We compare 14 insurance quotes to get you the best deal. So choose chill and work smarter, not harder.
Drizzle and patchy rain will affect Munster and southern Leinster this morning, with central and northern areas staying drier but mostly cloudy to overcast. Winds will be light and northwesterly. This afternoon, you'll see drizzle and patchy rain become more restricted to the south, with low cloud bringing more foggy conditions to coastal hills and mountains inland. Increasing amounts of sunshine elsewhere as the day progresses. Top temperatures this afternoon of around 16 to 21 degrees. And widely dry with clear spells for most parts tonight, but patchy rain will extend into Leinster and Connacht later on. Widely dry by tomorrow morning. Lows tonight of around 7 to 16 degrees.
Chill Insurance work harder, so you can work smarter. We compare 14 quotes to get you the best deal.
Hiya, you're very welcome back. Now, earlier on, we were talking to Dr. Mally Coyne and parenting coach Aoife Lee about sharenting. And we all know this. We're on social media, see people who constantly just bombard it with pictures of their children and whatever else. And even another issue, what we're talking about, is actually whatever about the family not doing, the parents not sharing, but their parents or grandparents or brothers and sisters.
Proud grandparents. Yeah.
But then you don't know where these pictures are going to end up. That's the problem with the world, with the internet. Once it's out there, it's gone.
Yeah, Hazel says, as a parent, it worries me greatly when creches and schools share. I didn't know creches and schools were allowed to share pictures on a daily basis on social media. As Tommy said, it's a very dark side of the net, and even when you give permission, you just don't know who will see those images, and this is true.
But then you have a right not to tick the box, right? But then the kid mightn't be included in that picture.
Yeah.
It doesn't feel like they're being left out.
They'll ask you whether you're open to the kids' pictures being put online.
Yeah.
Why would they want the kids put online?
They put them up on their Facebook page for the creche, like end of year graduation,
right,
or whatever.
Okay.
Sinead, in my experience, younger parents are a lot more careful online. It's usually the grandparents that overshare on Facebook, although it is in good faith. I don't think they realise the dangers of social media.
The thing is, a lot of grandparents, whatever, their profiles are private.
Yes.
So if your profiles are private, it's fine. But when somebody has an open profile picture and they're putting it on social media, anybody can see it.
But the statistics of children's photos ending up in nefarious websites are huge. Like, it's terrifying where they can end up.
It's more my question as well, Muireann, is that if you're putting up loads of pictures of your children, whatever else, and making, like, there's lots of funny things. I mean, sick over the, like, making a fool out of themselves. But then they grow up and they're like, that's not cool. You know, you're showing those pictures online anymore. Or even, like, YouTube. Like, my kids love following these young kids who are being filmed with millions of subscribers making an absolute fortune. But their parents are kind of profiteering off their children.
And these children are growing up, they're famous for just being children, which is wrong.
But as we're saying that France are considering bringing in legislation in relation to, they're using the word sharenting, the French version of sharenting, saying that you parents might have the right to post about their children taken off them.
It's all about a balance, isn't it? It's lovely that if you're in another part of the world and you're seeing your niece and your nephews growing up,
that's lovely
to see it.
And having a parent and a closed WhatsApp group or Facebook page, whatever else, would be brilliant for
that. It's very good. Social media is great and it does a lot of good. We have family abroad and it's great for seeing the nieces, nephews and cousins, says Jen. My sister probably overshares, but she says, it's no harm. I disagree and try to post as little as possible. If loved ones want to see your children, just private message them and don't brag about them online, but each to their
own. Thank you. Yeah, absolutely. You know? Listen, really appreciate you sending in all your texts on everything this morning.
Yes, certainly. Sorry, this is me. Up next, Sinitta will be joining us to talk about her brand new podcast series. Talk to you shortly.
So macho. Gonna be so macho.
Well, viewers may remember her from her time on The X Factor. And that leaves outfit.
We just got it. Oh, there we go.
Oh, there it is.
There we go.
Wowie.
I mean, sustainability.
Absolutely. But long before Sinitta was helping Simon Cowell find some megastars, she was making waves in the music charts.
But before we chat to the woman herself, let's take a snippet of Sinitta's hit song, which Alan's like, I don't sound very macho when I sing this, but Tommy does. Here is So Macho on Ireland AM. So macho.
Wow.
Could be about you.
Love it.
Good morning, Sinitta. How are you doing?
Good morning. I'm really well, thank you. That video cracks me up. I mean, if I'd known that we were going to be still seeing that video 100 years later, I might have done it a little differently.
What? But it's good crack, isn't it?
Great.
It's like Whitney Houston on the dance with somebody. It's fun.
It is fun. It is fun. It just makes me laugh. It just makes me laugh because, you know, I can still remember every second of making, because it was my very first video, our first hit. So, you know, it's just like you just go straight back to those times when you see it.
So before, when we talk about you, there's obviously the Simon Cowell and the X Factor, which a lot of people would remember you from. But you're, even for you to get into the music industry and to release such a hit as So Macho, like, what was your experience of getting into that? Like, was it like the X Factor or like it is now?
It was completely unlike the X Factor. I mean, we had to do everything the real hard way. I feel like X Factor is a fast track to fame because you get instant recognition because millions of people watching you on TV. You know, you've got Simon there, who's the big sort of record industry mogul, and the record company there to sign you. So it's a big fast track. Whereas we were nobody. Simon was nobody at that time as well. And we used to just schlep about in this mini all over the country to nightclubs and radio stations, sort of begging people to play our record. And eventually, when the record became popular in the clubs and people started to request it and then ask for it on the radio, it gradually became a hit. But it took a long time.
And with that, I suppose you've started out with the person who became one of the most famous and powerful people in entertainment, certainly in the Western world, Sinitta. So he shows an awful lot of loyalty because people became obsessed with your relationship with him. Were they together? Weren't they together? His sort of group of women that he always had around him. What was that like living in that bubble?
Do you know what? Because Simon and I grew up together, I think we were just kind of used to it. It became strange when people started to call us and our group of friends a harem. That was kind of odd. My mother wasn't very happy, or my church. You know, because in the old days, all the news was on newspapers rather than on social media. And so we kind of had to adapt. And we had the attitude of, oh, you know, it doesn't matter about these stupid stories. It'll be fish and chip paper by the weekend and everyone will forget about it. Of course, now it never disappears. It's there forever. So it's strange. But I mean, mostly I used to laugh at the stupid stories because, you know, sometimes the headlines and things were quite amusing. Mm.
Do you remember who gave you your big break? Because you mentioned there you tried to get people to listen to it. Eventually, radio DJs put it on. Do you remember what it was that really took you to the next level?
I think it was Radio 1 having to play it because it was rocketing up the charts and there was a demand for it in the record stores. It was selling out. It was selling more records than we were able to print because we were just a tiny little record company. You know, I was the only artist. We'd never done it before. And eventually it was selling so much that we kind of rocketed up to number 2 in the charts. And some of the radio stations that were a bit reluctant because it wasn't proper music had to start playing it. And it was the best feeling in the world. Listening to the chart rundown on a Sunday afternoon and hearing In With A Rocket, It's Sinitta and So Matcha, I nearly passed. Pasta.
That argument is still happening today. The fights about whether it's real music and like your songs, it stood the test of time.
Absolutely.
You'll always bloom and hear it. And when people talk about that time in your life, something that always comes up as well, it's the picture of you and Brad Pitt. And did they date? Didn't they date? What's going on there? That's a nice thing to haunt you, isn't it?
Big time.
I mean, you know, it's not too shabby. I mean, I have to say that my exes are, you know, are pretty good. I mean, although I didn't know that they were going to turn out to be the biggest record mogul in the world, the biggest movie star in the world. But they were just really, really sweet, fun guys at the time. So I think I have good taste in men.
God bless the boyfriends after them.
You set a pretty high bar, didn't you?
Yeah, because like I did this dating show last year and I was so excited because I thought, well, they know the kind of men I like. They didn't quite get it right.
Was this Celebs Go Dating?
Yeah. I mean, the men I met were really lovely. They were lovely people, but one lived like at the top of Scotland, you know, on his in a sort of a tree sanctuary. One was, I mean, it was just, they were just not suitable, but they were really nice guys. But I was thinking, how could you get it so wrong? It's very easy. I like men like Simon and Brad Pitt.
Well, in the middle of a tree sanctuary, I mean, you'd have any amount of leaves for outfits, given exactly. We just had your leaf outfit from...
Yeah, that was the upside, but it was kind of like, you know. So I think I'm better picking for myself.
And how was that during the X Factor when, you know, the way it was, there's obviously been hugely successful artists to come from it, but you were part and parcel of it for so many years. You brought the fun, as we can see right there. And it was about kind of shocking and get people to talk about what you were doing in the houses. In what, like, did you plan what you were going to do, or was it all just a bit of fun?
I literally, everything, you know, including So Macho video, everything I've done seems to sort of happen at the last minute. I seem to be better when I'm caught off the hoof. So they were expecting me to come out in a bikini. I didn't want to wear a bikini that day. Wasn't bikini ready. You know, sometimes as a woman, you're not. And so it was like, oh, I know, I'll wear this. And it was just a stupid thing. I didn't think I believed it would make the actual cut. It was supposed to be more like a joke on Simon. But his reaction was so priceless because he just lost it, fell to pieces. The contestants all fell about laughing. And the next thing you know, when it came out, it was in the show. But what really happened on the day is I was, okay, Sinitta, haha, very funny, get changed. And we shot it all again. So I didn't know it would actually end up in the final edit.
Brilliant.
It's absolutely brilliant. Classic as well. Well, listen, it's there forever. Like you said, with social media, it doesn't go away now as well. You've decided to join the world of podcast. Well, this is your second go at it, yep. I think, as well. But your new podcast, Pod Tales, what made you want to give it a go?
I am very creative. I have a lot of energy and I just thought, I'm just going to start, you know, I'm in my 50s. I'm just going to do everything I ever wanted to do. And some of it will stick and be appreciated. Some of it will not. And some of it will be a disaster. But I actually genuinely don't mind. So I'm so pleased that someone's actually watched it and seen it and that you've invited me on. Because, you know, you don't know. But I think with things like this, you have to be brave and just think, look, I find these things interesting. I'm going to film it. I'm going to put it out there. And hopefully someone will find it entertaining.
What are you talking about in the podcast, Sinitta? What sort of things are you dealing with?
Well, I'm talking with everything. I'm discovering new talent. I'm talking to people about aesthetic therapies because, you know, treatments and fillers and all this stuff is very, very popular now. I had a load of fillers done a few years ago when I lost too much weight and then very painfully had to spend the last 2 years getting it all removed, which is why I now look like me again. I'm doing lots of stuff with women in their 50s and 60s about sex and love and, you know, what we do with the rest of our lives now. That's coming up. That's not released yet, called Sin's Angels. Just kind of living life and excited because my children are like 17 and 18 now. You know, I'm not signed to a record label. I don't have a permanent role on anything. So I'm kind of free to do what I like, go on holiday when I like just, you know, meet someone gorgeous and have an amazing time. Wow. And I think it's please kind of celebrate it and also hopefully encourage other women, because there's lots of stuff about menopause and the difficult part of being older, but not enough, I think, about the fun part.
I would imagine it's going to be fantastic, and no doubt you'll be able to pull in some pretty incredible interviews and some incredible guests as well. Sinitta, it is called Sinitta Podtails. If anybody wants to get it, just get it from wherever you listen to your podcasts. Sinitta, it's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you for joining us this morning.
Thank you so much. Honestly, this is lovely. Thank you so much. It was lovely to speak to you.
Well, hopefully we'll get you on again soon.
Just someone, if we've got someone somewhere between Simon Cowell and Brad Pitt. Not asking too much, lads.
No,
okay?
No big deal. Lots more still to come here in Ireland. Stay with us. We'll see you after the break. Now, are you someone who hates conflict and avoids it at all costs, or do you prefer to sort an issue out as soon as it happens?
Both sound awful. Well, that may down to you. It may be down to your attachment style. And here to tell us just exactly what attachment styles are and how they affect our relationships is relationship coach Lisa McFarland. Welcome back, Lisa. It's lovely to have you here.
Thank you for having
me. This is doing the round on TikTok majorly at the minute. Mm-hmm. It is attachment style. So what does this mean?
OK, well, first of all, the book is excellent. It's called Attached. The book is excellent. So read the book if you're very interested in this subject.
Yeah, but Ali Ryan, who's going to be doing Showbiz later, swears by it. Yeah.
She loves it. Yeah.
Who's it by?
I don't know.
We were chatting.
No, not that.
Someone.
No. Who's the book by? Do we know?
It's two ladies, psychotherapists, but they talk about how it happens because of the way we were brought up and things like that. But now the new research is also telling us that it's the relationships that we're in as adults that can also affect our attachment style.
So another thing to blame on our parents.
But it's our job to work this stuff out for ourselves as grown-ups now.
So what are the different types?
So secure, anxious, avoidant are the three main. And there's a free test online. It's called the attachment style test. So you go and you do your attachment style test online. Okay. And it's just about recognising these things within ourselves. So maybe your partner wants to talk about something and you're like, no, we're not doing that now. We're not talking about it. I'm never going to discuss it. We have to say to ourselves, oh, I'm avoiding that subject, so there's definitely an avoidant part of me. Or maybe you're a partner who wants to talk about things and you want the texts and you have to know everything that's going on. You're like, oh, that's my anxious attachment style coming up. So it's just about recognising them in ourselves and then doing the work to become more secure in ourselves and within our relationship.
Okay, so what, say if someone's at home and they're kind of like, they might be reluctant to go and do one of these tests because they're like, okay, what's this going to tell me and do I really want to know? So what are the... Because when it... Like, you might just be sitting there going, it's a test online. What's it really going to tell me about myself? So what sort of questions are they...
So they'd be avoidant attachment style.
Right, okay.
So can you kind of... Can you break people down to three different topics, really?
Yeah, and then there's subtopics within it as well. But again, it's about doing the work to become secure ourselves. It's the inner work to love and accept ourselves, to know our greatness, and then want to find someone to journey this lifetime with.
Okay. So, because if you want to have a good relationship, it's very important to know about yourself.
Yes.
And then that explains and might make it easier. But what,
and be as secure. It's our job to be secure. Now, obviously, when you're in a relationship, that's going to affect it. If you're in a relationship with somebody who treats you badly, that's going to affect, even if you've done all the work on yourself to make yourself secure, it's going to affect that. So you want two secure attachment styles building a great relationship.
So then it doesn't become, you know, the way you think yin and yang and kind of he makes up for what I don't have, he makes up for it and I do this. No, essentially, it's not like an avoidant person is okay with a dismissive person. No. You have to try to get to secure.
That's polarity. And we absolutely want polarity within relationships.
Okay, so kind of opposites, you balance each other out.
A dishwasher person and a non-dishwasher person.
Okay,
we talked about this before.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yep.
Or maybe a talkative extrovert, more with a shy, caring, my husband,
introvert.
We call him The Rock, because he's just like steady and I'm like all over the place all the time.
Okay. Gotcha.
So polarity is what we want in relationships, but we want two secure people who have polarity.
Okay. So we did these attachment styles, right? So,
oh dear.
Right.
Now,
can we explain when Tommy did his test? Because I would say do it when, you know, you're feeling yourself. You haven't just been at a four-day wedding.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I've been on a bender pretty much for the last 3 days mm-hmm. and have was feeling a little bit sorry for myself
and
yesterday.
In the north, and we do it right in the north.
So,
and
you're a bit needy and you needed hugs. Needy.
I was
so
feeling a bit abandoned. So I am anxious, preoccupied. What does that mean?
Well, first of all, I can't believe it for one
He's
second.
He's not. We're all in the studio going,
insecure attachment
secure.
Styles.
It's very hard to answer these things for yourself, though.
But so, well, let's break it down a bit. I'm secure attachment style, okay?
Okay.
But when I would get into conflict, I could be anxious, okay?
Okay.
So I want to talk it to death. I want to say, why can it never happen again? What can we put in place? So we all, even if we do all the work on ourselves, we all maybe just have this little bit that's rumbling around, okay? And maybe you're with someone who is very secure but has avoidant. You know, they're like almost default is avoidant. So you have an anxious and your anxious wants to talk and talk and talk and your avoidant's like, we've discussed it. It's over. Mm-hmm. You know, let's move on. And it doesn't help the anxious. Yeah. So it's about getting that right balance.
And for him, anxious, preoccupied. So he's preoccupied with other things that are going on in his life. That's
that could
true?
Be possibly true.
Yeah, like, yeah. That's probably
you'd need
true,
a psychotherapist
right.
to really dive into this.
Anxious, it's preoccupied.
It's about seeing. Like, so if your partner came to you and said, "I feel you're really anxious about that," you can go, "Oh, I actually did that test and it said I was anxious about that. Maybe that's something for me to look at."
But sure, that's the way you are. Like, can you change it?
Yeah, I was a huffer for 25 years.
A what?
Huffing, you know, stonewalling.
Oh.
I huffed for 25 years and when I went to therapy, I huffed with the therapist for the whole session.
Huffed.
Okay.
So, huffed that.
That was my avoidant. I'm, you know, emotionally going to shut you off. Huffing is a terrible, terrible, terrible trait.
You can shut other people off. Mm-hmm. Yeah, whatever.
It's terrible.
Puff and puff.
It's terrible straight. And you can change.
I'm dismissive avoidant. Seems about right, doesn't it?
What does that mean?
Just move on. Let's just get over it. Let's move on.
Bye-bye. Move on.
Oh, really?
Let's move on. We're not discussing that. We're not going to go too deep into that. We're not going to deal with that. Let's just put the box over there and we'll move on.
So is it important if you are in a relationship to do this with your partner?
Is it not good?
We have to work on that.
Is that not good? If you just ignore it, it's fine. Don't
Start
worry about
therapy
it.
After the show.
Huff and puff and blow your house down, my friend.
Is this something you would recommend for couples to do?
Yeah.
To get to know each other?
Yeah, and also we have been programmed to have this other half. They complete me. I need another half. I'm not worth love because I don't have anybody. This is not true. It is, we have to get away from it. I thought we'd come away from it because I'm older than you guys and it's all Pretty Woman and Jerry Maguire. Mm-hmm. I thought we'd come away from it. It's about knowing that you're so special and you deserve to have somebody who's also so special and you deserve to build a beautiful relationship with someone.
Okay, and it starts with doing an online questionnaire.
Yes, which is also free.
Okay. I'll go buy the book.
And absolutely, you don't have to go to therapy, do the online test, easier than going to therapy, you don't have to pay for it. But then find these things out about yourself and then do the work on yourself, which might mean going to therapy and a bit of coaching.
Yeah.
But you want to be the best version of you and love and accept yourself. We're so poor in this country at loving and accepting ourselves for all the differences that we are.
Yeah.
And we have to work on that.
Hello to all my dismissive, avoidant girls out there.
I'm anxious, preoccupied.
But next time, we'll learn how to do conflict well.
Okay.
We're going to do that next time.
How because your attachment well. Styles come into your conflict style.
Okay. The book is called, Ali Ryan says that it's her Bible, she loves it. It's called
loves
Attached.
It.
You can just Google it there. Lisa McFarland, relationship coach, as always, thank you so much for joining
thank
us.
Thank you so much.
Lisa.
Thanks, guys. Thank you.
Huffin.
I love Huffin.
Let's get out to Alan now, the Huffer, and find out what's coming next.
Definitely.
We're in Ali Ryan's going to kill you, Lenny. All our secrets out there.
He said it was Tommy.
Nothing to do with me. Let's move on. Coming up, it's going to be a busy time in showbiz, and we have all the latest goss after the break. Thanks for staying with us. Now it's time for your roundup of our showbiz gossip. And who else would bring us a roundup of showbiz gossip than Ali Ryan from goss.ie?
Number one fan of attached styles.
Styles.
I do give it to all my friends and to many boys. It's worth reading. It just really explains the relationships, why they didn't work out. And sometimes you need to give it to a guy and be like, just sort it out. You need to know what you are.
So, in, I might actually look at this book.
Maybe have a read of it later.
Avoidant dismissive, I probably won't.
Anyway, so we're going to start off with a sad story.
Yes.
And this is Sandra Bullock and Brian Randall, a guy that she's known since 2015.
Yeah, it's so sad.
And their partner, and he passed away.
Yeah, I feel like Sandra has not had a really easy ride with love. I mean, you might remember she had a really famous divorce from Jesse James years ago. He cheated on her with multiple women. It was just an awful situation. And then she kind of went on her own for a while. She adopted a child. And then just as she went to adopt her second child, she met Brian. So he was a photographer turned model, or model, sorry, turned photographer. He was booked to take photos of her son for his birthday. It was a really gorgeous, just fairy tale story. And they were very private, though. They were seen at Justin Theroux and Jennifer Aniston's wedding. But other than that, very, very private. So nobody knew about this, but battling ALS for the last 3 years.
So that's MND, as we call it here, motor neurone disease.
And what really frustrates me is that literally only a couple of days ago, there was reports that they were splitting, that they hadn't been seen together, they weren't living together, which is not true.
They hadn't been seen together because, like, according to her sister, her sister praised her, sort of saying how much she's cared for him over the last 3 years.
Yeah, it sounds like she was there every single day. She also assembled a team of nurses for him. It's such a sad situation because she is very private, but in 2021 she came out and she said, I finally found the love of my life. So it's just, and at 57, it's very young. Normally, you know, motor neurone disease, it can go, it's anywhere from 1 to 10 years. Some people have lived longer. I'm sure she tried everything she could, and the fact
and she got the medical team.
So very, very sad. I do think she's one of America's sweethearts, and I think a lot of really sad
everybody
people.
Loves Sandra Bullock.
But for anyone who's seen that disease in action, you know, you just hope that he was okay in his final few days, because it is, it's an awful, awful disease. So God bless her. Her partner since 2015 has passed away, age of 57, from motor neuron disease. So just thought it's absolutely horrible for her young children to have to look at that. We're going to move on to another story. Natalie Portman and her husband, Benjamin Millepied, they've been together. He was a choreographer on Black Swan. And they've been together since then, right?
Let me take you back to this, right? So Black Swan 2009, he actually left his long-term girlfriend, who was a US ballerina, or Natalie Portman. Those were the reports at the time. Now, they were just rumours, they were reports. People thought maybe she was just angry, the ex, because she came out, did a big interview and was like, I was living with him all during Black Swan. So we move forward now to 11 years later, and last summer, basically, a report came out that he had been having an affair with a very young 25-year-old climate activist. All the kind of, you know, sources reveal at the time were saying it's fine, they're going to work through it. But she was in Sydney last week, spotted without her wedding ring, and now it's coming out that they're separating. And they have two young kids, but does a leopard ever change its spots? I don't know. I don't know. It's not shocking to me, because I remember reading that story at the time. But yes, they fell in love on the set of Black Swan. We've kind of seen this before, as we'll be talking about Strictly in a few minutes, when there's people together that intensely, especially dancing all over each other, these things happen. And it did seem like a true love story, but we're over a decade later now, and it looks like he's been bold
again. Like it's gone. And we are talking about the Strictly curse of breakups. And people, like,
literally, I don't know.
Living with somebody for months at a time.
And maybe I need to go on one of these shows.
Just to see what happens. Sparks.
Yeah,
so the great news about it for the Irish perspective is that Angela Scanlon has been signed for Strictly.
I'm so, so excited. So she's already been chatting about it. She said she's been approached actually a couple of times over the last few years, but she has two young kids. She was becoming a mom, she was busy. She's finally said yes. I'm dying to see her on the dance floor, because we were saying earlier on, she's just a gas character. She's really, really funny.
Yeah.
I think she'll bring so much personality. I don't know if she can dance. No idea.
She has a frenetic energy, and I've seen her be behind the scenes at Ask Me Anything, the show she does obviously in Ireland. And she can move. Like, I think she's just a girl that you see on the dance floor at 2 a.m.
She's energetic.
And
she'll fun.
She was incredibly funny with Gabby Rosin when it was announced. And she was like, I've had two kids. I don't know if my pelvic floor is going to be able for this. I was like, I love her. I want her to win already.
I feel like she's going to somehow have the coolest outfits that I've ever seen on Strictly. But look, it's a huge deal for her. I love having an Irish person on Strictly myself.
Yeah.
But just for her and her career, it just brings you up another notch when you're asked to do Strictly. It's a huge deal.
Yeah.
And finally, and it's been happening for a while, because an awful lot of Love Islanders always say, I want to go on Strictly, I want to go on Strictly, I want to go on Strictly.
Them.
And they've never gotten them. But Sarah McDermott has made it.
Sarah's kind of a profile on her own, because as well as Love Island, she was on Made in Chelsea. Her boyfriend, Sam Thompson, was from Made in Chelsea. The two of them have cultivated this amazing career.
Yeah.
They're on podcasts. He's on After Sun on Love Island. The two of them are just becoming really hot properties. So I think this makes really good sense. She's also lovely, but she brings the drama too. She's done reality TV shows twice before. She's going to know what to do, and she's going to look stunning as well. I think the lineup so far, Angela Rippon, you're delighted about.
Angela Rippon is doing a former BBC news presenter. And if people remember years and years back, the Morecambe and Wise special, when she literally...
Her legs.
They came from behind the desk.
The Angela Rippon
And she's
legs.
Going to be the oldest person.
78. Yeah.
She's going to be the oldest person ever to take part in Strictly. She looks amazing.
Yeah, she does a show with like Gloria Hunterford, whatever, where they catch people trying to scam people out. She's brilliant.
Yeah.
I think they've really got the lineup right so far. Yes. There's a few more people to be revealed, but as it stands, I'm happy.
We're all set. We're watching
we're excited.
It. Very quickly, Harry and Meghan have bought the rights for a new, and they want a new Netflix show.
They bought the rights to a book that, of course, is from Prince Harry's own book house for Spare that bought that from Penguin. So it's called Meet Me at the Lake. It's about two star-crossed lovers. One of the main characters' mothers died in a car crash, then becomes addicted to drugs and alcohol. Does any of this sound familiar? But look, I think they needed something to come back out with. They were dropped from Spotify. They're losing money. They do have a deal with Netflix that still stands. They're meant to be producing shows, producing movies. This does look like a good deal. You're into books, Maureen. Is this a good book? Do you know
I wouldn't pick it up off the shelves personally myself. But sure, listen.
So there you go.
It's probably going to be number one then. If it's going to be cheesy crap.
Yeah. It'll be you know Harry and Meghan anyway.
Yeah.
Well, listen.
Anyway, it sounds like it's about them. So
so that's it.
Ali, as always, thank you so much from goss.ie.
Thank you, Ali. So much. Cheers.
Now, on tomorrow's show, I'm going to be live in Mullingar at the Fla. Get your dancing shoes on.
Looking forward to that. Norma Sheehan is going to be dropping by for a chat.
And we'll have all your usual news, sport and weather. We'll talk to you then from 7 a.m. on Virgin Media One. Bye.